We are live. Hello, everyone. My name is Carolina. I'm the education manager at INWI Migration, and we are going live today on all our platforms. We're live on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram to talk today a little bit about education and applying for a study permit. Why is Canada a good option for immigration and to study? And also the important things that you need to keep in mind in order to have a successful application. Estamos esperando hoy un poco que se conecten nuestros seguidores. Mi nombre es Carolina. Soy la encargada del Departamento de Educación de nuestra agencia INWI. Y hoy queremos llevarles contenido referente a el permiso de estudio. Vamos a hacer una sesión bilingüe con Laura. Hi, Laura. How are you doing?
Hi, Carolina. Hi, everyone.
Yeah, well, Laura is going to be helping me with the Spanish questions and everything. We want to help you understand what is important and what things you should do and should not do, maybe, in order to have a successful application. Studies nowadays is one of the most important path to come to Canada. Many of our clients choose this path because it might not be the shortest, but it's definitely a very secure way to come to Canada, to immigrate, to gain experience, to get to know the culture, the country, and then on top of all of that, having access to convert to PR and stay here as a permanent resident. Básicamente, queremos entregarles las herramientas para lograr una aplicación exitosa. Hoy en día el permiso de estudio es una de las herramientas y los caminos principales por los que nuestros clientes emigran y vienen a Canadá. No es un proceso necesariamente corto, pero es un proceso bastante seguro que les entrega no solo la posibilidad de integrarse de mejor manera a la cultura, a la sociedad, sino que además después ofrece distintos caminos para luego convertir a la residencia permanente. So let's just start right away. Why is Canada a good option nowadays? So the answer is very simple. Number one, it's many alternatives for immigration. In terms of all English-speaking countries that offer studies like Australia or New Zealand, even the US, Canada offers a lot more alternatives for students to stay in the country, to work in the country, and then after convert to PR. Second, I would say the openness. You have Canada, as you know, is a very multicultural place, is a very welcoming country. So that is a very important thing when you go and you travel by yourself or with your family and the small kids. It's really important that you feel welcome, that you get used to the country. And that, in that sense, Canada is a very friendly and open country. Third of all, I would definitely mention the prices. In terms of English-speaking countries, the tuition fees for colleges and universities, they vary a lot. You have a wide range of prices, but it definitely is a lot more competitive than, again, places like Australia or New Zealand. So Lau, you can help me a little bit with that, the Spanish folks.
Yeah, sure. Tomando un poco lo que estaba diciéndonos Carolina en español, pues el tema en cierta forma general de lo que estamos hablando en este momento son las cosas importantes que necesitamos saber antes de planear viajar a Canadá en 2022. Entonces estábamos diciendo como varios puntos positivos que tiene Canadá en comparación a otros países. Uno de ellos es que hay muchas alternativas de inmigración para Canadá, o sea, en comparación con Estados Unidos, Australia o algunos otros países, Canadá ofrece más alternativas para poder inmigrar allá. También es un país cultural, es muy amigable y también es abierto para todas las personas. Y otro punto que es importante de Canadá, que también se tiene que tener en cuenta, son los precios. Pueden variar un poco, pero estos precios son más competitivos y asequibles para cualquier persona.
Así es. Básicamente, es una de las mejores opciones hoy en día, and that's why we wanted to tell you about how to get here. ¿No? Por eso mismo queremos explicarles cómo acceder a esta opción de estudios en Canadá. Starting, what's the first step? What's the first step to actually being able to come to Canada and study? The first step is choosing a program, choosing a school, and then getting an acceptance letter, right? Now, when choosing a program, that's the main key. That's the most important thing. What we've seen with our clients is that when people are looking for programs, they, for example, think about the programs in their home country or their professions in their home countries. For example, nurses. We have a nurse in their home country, and they come to Canada, they want to come to Canada, and they say, well, I'm going to study nursing. That, for example, might not be the best choice. Because remember, the most important thing is to get an approval for a study permit is to convince the officer why you want to come to Canada. It has to make sense. Why now? Why in this moment? You chose Canada, you chose that specific school and that specific program, and you want to come to study. So that has to make sense. So if you apply for the same program, for example, that you already studied back home, might not be the best choice. And it's a logical assumption that the officer will question, well, why you want to come to Canada and study exactly the same thing. So for example, in those cases, yeah, it's great to have alternatives, maybe in the same field, but study something. Canadian education is very specialized, so you will always find a program that maybe is in the same field, but it adds something to your current knowledge. So that is suggestion number one. When you're studying and when you're choosing the program, you need to try to add to your background and your interests, but add, not to do the same, and adding something that hopefully will help you with your employment in the future. Remember that employment plus immigration, they are very together. Finding a job after you finish your studies is very important for immigration. It's required by many provincial nominee programs. So it's a very important thing to do. So number one, choosing the program, what to study. Don't think about your program at home. Or what your background is at home, think about the country that you are arriving at. You're coming to Canada. What are high demand occupations in Canada? What will I be able to do? How can I add to my current experience or work experience, my studies? Always adding something. Laura, can you tell us a little bit about that in Spanish?
Yeah, sure. Estábamos nombrando los pasos para poder aplicar pues ya idealmente de la mejor forma para estudiar en Canadá. Entonces el primer paso que se tiene que tener en cuenta es escoger un programa y conseguir la carta de aceptación. Este paso de escoger un programa es muy importante porque no solamente es escoger un programa porque sí, sino que toca analizar ya sea los estudios previos o también la experiencia laboral que ha tenido esa persona para que el programa tenga sentido. Por ejemplo, si una persona estudió enfermería en el pasado y está ejerciendo enfermería en este momento y quiere aplicar a Canadá a un programa de enfermería, no tendría sentido porque ya tiene tanto la experiencia como la educación en esa área. Entonces tendría que buscar una forma de escoger un programa que le aporte algo más. Entonces eso es como la importancia también de escoger un programa ideal para inmigración que tenga sentido y que no sea igual, sino que aporte a sus estudios o a su experiencia. Entonces eso Excellent. Es como un breve resumen.
Yes. Yes, thank you very much. That was pretty good. I talk a lot, so you can definitely just stop me. But that was pretty awesome. So yes, definitely background, interest, and employability, right? The other thing that is very important, of course, everybody worries about this, it's tuition fees, right? Tuition fees sometimes, depending on the countries, can be a little bit challenging because, of course, if you compare with, for example, our countries, I'm from Chile, Laura is from Colombia, obviously the tuition fees can be a little bit challenging to cover. However, there are many different types. There's a wide range of tuition fees. I'm only going to talk about public colleges at the moment because those are the colleges that you want to look at if you're immigrating to Canada. I mean, if you come to Canada with the objective of immigration, you should only look into public colleges. Private colleges are an option for very specific things, I would say, but not for immigration. It can be a tool in the process, but not your main choice, okay? That's very important. So public colleges, in terms of tuition, you're going to find, for example, the lowest tuition fees, you're going to find them in the Atlantic, right, Laura? Atlantic Canada, which is New Brunswick, PEI, Newfoundland. Those are, you can find programs of 10,000, 11,000, Nova Scotia as well. Then you have a wide range. If you move to Toronto or Vancouver, which are larger urban areas, then you have to think about 15,000 to 17,000 Canadian dollars. And then after that, there's a variety of programs. For example, some masters can be very expensive, 60,000 and all of that. But normally, the in terms of coming to Canada with 15,000 a year, there's definitely options, lots of options. But it's a key when you're deciding which program, you know. If you have this amount of money, then try to find a program that goes with your budget at the end of the day.
Para resumir un poco en español lo que estaba diciendo Carolina acerca de nuestro segundo paso, entonces el segundo paso que se tiene en cuenta al estudiar en Canadá, el primero, como nos dimos cuenta, es escoger un programa. El segundo es escoger, pues ya complementar eso, escoger un programa teniendo en cuenta la economía o el presupuesto que se tiene para ese programa. Hay dos opciones, o colegios privados o colegios públicos. En cuanto a los colegios privados, sí tienden a ser más económicos, pero no es una opción a largo plazo ni para inmigración, entonces solemos aconsejar muchísimo más los colegios públicos, y ahí hay varias opciones. Hay provincias en donde pueden encontrarse programas más económicos, como son las provincias del Atlántico, New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, no sé cuáles son las otras, no me acuerdo, Carolina.
PEI, Newfoundland.
Exacto.
Prince
Edward. Y esas tienen un promedio de precio, de presupuesto de $10,000. Ya en provincias más grandes como Toronto, ahí aumenta lo que es la matrícula, entonces costaría unos 16,000, 17,000. Igualmente depende del programa, entonces eso puede variar.
Exactly. And just wanted to add there that a lot of people ask, that's a very common question. Well, how much money do I need to show when I am applying for a study permit? In that sense, I always say the ideal would be your first year of tuition. Let's say your college is 15,000 Canadian dollars a year. So that first year, those $15,000 plus $10,000 for maintenance, right? That's the ideal. So if your program costs 15,000 a year, then ideally you should be able to show 25,000. So the government is making sure basically that you have the resources to cover all of your, at least the first year of your studies. Now, will they refuse your application because you don't have that money? Not necessarily. It depends a lot on other aspects of your application, age, as I mentioned, like how logical is your proposal of studying here in Canada, your background. All those aspects play a role, but that would be the ideal amount.
Continuando con la parte monetaria, ya estamos hablando de los tuition fees, de las matrículas, pero también otra pregunta que la gente suele hacerse es cuánto dinero se debe mostrar para el gobierno de Canadá. Entonces, lo que estábamos diciendo es que idealmente se deben demostrar $10,000 más el año del programa que se va a asistir. Por ejemplo, si el año del programa cuesta $15,000, entonces más los $10,000 se tendrían que demostrar aproximadamente unos $25,000. Eso sería como a grandes rasgos el dinero a demostrar. Ya le van a rechazarte la aplicación en caso de no poder demostrar ese dinero, Puede ser, pero no necesariamente. O sea, no es como una razón del por qué van a rechazar. O sea, puede serlo, pero hay otras razones más, como lo que es, no sé, que el plan de estudios no concuerde o que no se tengan lazos con el país. Entonces, hay múltiples razones para eso. No necesariamente por no tener el dinero se va a recibir un rechazo.
Así es. Another aspect that I think it's very important, it's the province. Okay, the province in two different aspects. Province meaning location. Where are you going to study? Where are you gonna come to Canada? Canada is a beautiful country, but the different provinces offer different things. So in terms of provincial nominee programs, each province has their own offering of different options, and some of them are a lot more favorable for students than others. So that is a very, very important question that you should ask yourself. The other thing in terms of location is the prices. As we mentioned before, some provinces are going to be have lower prices. Some others are going to be always going to be more expensive. Finally, and it's very important, a lot of people don't think about it, but are you going to get used to living there? I always give this example, Saskatchewan. Saskatchewan is a great province. Lots of things to do. I mean, lots of options for immigration, I'm sorry. It's a very affordable, there is employment, but for example, the weather is very, very tough. Also, maybe there is not many things to do in terms of for a person that, for example, is used to living in the city and going to bars and having lots of things to go to. It's not the scenery for somebody like that. So a lot of people, even though there are great opportunities there, like cheap programs, great immigration options, they decide not to go there because they will have to stay in the province for 2, 3, 4, 5 years, we don't know. So they don't see themselves there. So the immigration process itself is not easy. So if you come to a place where you don't feel welcome, where you feel that is very, there are very many adverse situations, might make it even worse. So I would say that that's a very important thing. So to summarize for Laura, location in terms of getting used to it, getting used to the place in terms of money, because it's going to vary, and in terms of PMPs.
Listo. En español, resumiendo un poco lo que estaba diciendo Carolina, otro aspecto importante es la provincia, escoger la provincia. Entonces, cada provincia tiene sus programas de nominación provincial, entonces es necesario analizar cuál de esos se adapta más a uno, porque hay provincias que tienen buenos programas de inmigración, hay otros que no tanto, entonces es ver eso. También, por otra parte, es el dinero, porque en provincias se gasta, el gasto es mayor, mientras que en otras no. Y por último, si yo estoy dispuesto y me gustaría vivir en esa provincia. Porque puede que la provincia cumpla porque tenga un buen programa de inmigración, también porque tenga sea más económica, pero si no me nace vivir en esa provincia, pues a la larga no se va a estar feliz. Pues la idea es que cuando uno esté en Canadá y esté estudiando, esté allá cómodo y se sienta bien.
Yes, exactly. And then I would like to discuss the study plan. The study plan is a key element. It's a key element in your application. The study plan is basically a letter that you write, you or your agent, it should be you, that basically explains why you want to come to Canada, why you today decided that Canada was a good option. Why your school? Why did you choose your school or your program? Refusals, the most common refusals that we get on study permits are because of financial means, saying, well, this person really doesn't have the means to cover. And the second one would be, it doesn't make sense what they are studying. The progression of a little bit of what I spoke at the beginning, the progression itself doesn't make any sense. And then also that there are no ties to the home country, okay? So the financial situation is pretty self-explanatory. It makes sense. In terms of the program that won't make in, that doesn't make any sense, I'm sorry. That's when exactly choosing the program and choosing the province and choosing everything, thinking on your background, everything has to come together at the end of the day. Changes in fields, in professions, that's something that a lot of people ask me. Like, for example, will I be refused if I am an engineer in my home country, but I just want to be a cook? Actually, sometimes if that has an explanation and documents to back it up, it's actually, it's doable, right? So when I say that it has to make sense, it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to only study your own field, but it has to make sense. For example, let's say, what does it mean to make sense? If, for example, you study you to become an engineer, you got your degree, but then you started a bakery at home, right? Because you realize that that's what you wanted. So if you show immigration, look, I really want to come to Canada to become a cook. I started my business. I've done things towards that goal. It would make sense for them. It would be like, okay, well, this person has this degree, but then it's changing routes, and then the education that they will receive in Canada will help them boost that business. For example, it's just a very general example to tell you that changes can happen, but everything has to be backed up, hopefully with documentation, and explaining in that document, the study permit, a little bit about your background, why you're applying, why you chose to come to Canada. There you can add, for example, economic reasons, what I said, for example, financial, the tuitions were more affordable, or I couldn't find this program in my home country. There are a lot of reasons why, but they have to be clearly stated in that document. That's the first thing that the officer is gonna look at to understand. Remember, they received thousands of applications with tons of documents. So they are gonna read this document, which is pretty much a summary of why, who are you, or who you are, why you're coming to Canada, why you choose a program, and what, how is that going to be of use to you in the future. So pretty much those are the main things to consider in terms of choosing the right program and adding that into your study plan for your application to study permit. Lara, do you need a reminder
I think that I have the information, but in case, you can help me to complement that.
For sure.
Entonces, retomando un poco ya en español, estamos diciendo que después ya de mencionar lo que es la provincia, la matrícula, el precio de la matrícula y también lo de escoger un programa, otro elemento clave es tener un buen plan de estudios. Entonces es un plan de estudios que se complemente con lo de la provincia, con lo de la experiencia laboral y lo de los estudios también previos. Así que a grandes rasgos, en resumidas cuentas, las razones del por qué se suele recibir un rechazo es porque no se tienen los fondos financieros. Eso pues ya se da a entender que no se cumple como con el dinero para poder aplicar y para poder mantenerse allá. El otro es que no tiene sentido el programa que se está estudiando. Ahí voy a poner el ejemplo que había puesto Carolina en inglés, y es que puede que haya una persona que se haya graduado de ingeniería y quiera aplicar en Canadá para ser un cocinero. No tendría como mucho sentido ese cambio de ingeniería a gastronomía, entonces sería mucho más complicado aplicar. Pero si esa persona que quiera hacer ese cambio tiene alguna justificación del por qué, quizás no ejerció la ingeniería, sino que tiene un restaurante y entonces, o ha estado trabajando en algo relacionado con la gastronomía, entonces por eso quiere estudiar esos tipos de programas, pues tendría sentido. Entonces, sí se pueden hacer esos cambios cuando ya es de una carrera completamente diferente a otra, siempre y cuando se pueda demostrar del por qué se está haciendo ese cambio. Entonces, por eso es importante tener un buen plan de estudios. Y también otra de las razones del por qué se suele tener un rechazo es porque no hay vínculos con el país de residencia. No sé si hay algo que...
We should add, we actually didn't talk too much about that. We should explain a little bit about what ties to the home country are. And so basically, the officers look at this in a way where Does the applicant have a good situation to go back to their home country in case something happens here in Canada, or in case they finish their studies and, for example, they are not able to get a work permit or they are not able to apply for PR? Are they okay to go back to their home country? Do they have still something there to support them and all of that? So basically, the government is trying to see what your options are. To see, well, we are opening your doors, we're opening doors, the Canadian doors here, but if something goes wrong, if you are not able to meet your goals, you can always go back. That is why, for example, depending on nationality, sometimes the refusal rates go higher, right? We have countries that are a little bit more complicated right now, like Venezuela, Iran, countries that we work a lot with, of course, the refusal rates are a lot higher because the government notes that the options of them to going back to their home countries are very slim because the conditions are not the best. So that is something that is very important to show in your on your study permit plan. Basically explain, look, I want to go to Canada. I have my financial means. I have all of this. This is my this is the reason why I chose my program. My program is gonna help me with this and that. And on top of that, I can always go back to my home country because I have this and this and that. For example, I have a job offer, or I have, for example, a house, or I have my family. All of those are ties to your home country that will help you in your application.
En resumidas cuentas, lo que está diciendo Carolina, ya enfocándonos en la parte de tener vínculos con el país de residencia, se refiere a que, pues, cuando uno envía la aplicación, uno tiene que tener como buenas razones para volver al país de residencia de uno en caso de no conseguir un permiso de trabajo o la residencia o de quedarse allá de forma legal. Entonces, que uno pueda volver en mi caso sería volver a Colombia para, no sé, para seguir esto, viviendo mi vida acá. Entonces, esos vínculos pueden ser, no sé, una oferta de trabajo, tener la familia acá, alguna propiedad, y eso va a potenciar la aplicación. Porque si yo tengo buenos fondos financieros, tengo un buen plan de estudios que se relacione ya sea con mi educación y con la experiencia laboral, y también tengo vínculos con el país de residencia, la aplicación va a ser muy positiva. Y pues hablando de posibilidades y de probabilidades, podría tener más posibilidad de recibir una aceptación.
Yes, and the last thing I wanted to discuss here, that it's always an issue, people always ask, well, should I apply through an agent? Should I do it myself? All of these applications are there on the Canadian website. You guys can access to them. You can apply by yourself. There is no rule that says you need an agent, right? So, however, a good agent is going to help you balance all of these things. It's going to give you advice on location, on the programs, on what to write on your study plan, what to add, what not to add. It will advise you on PMPs. It will advise you on employability. So basically, it will help you make a better, a more informed decision when starting your process. So when you come to Canada, you know you have a path, a clear path to follow. You know that, oh, in this province, I came here because the PMP is good for me, or I'm going to apply through the federal program. But you have a clear, and I know that, for example, the program that I chose is in high demand occupation, so it's not going to be so hard for me to find a job. All of those, nobody can guarantee you an acceptance. Absolutely nobody. Okay, and some agents will charge you such amount, some others, like everybody, you know, like in all the things in general, you're gonna have different pricing and different agents, and they all work differently. But as I said, a good agent can be really beneficial in those aspects, even though the process can be done by yourselves.
Para ir finalizando sobre este tema, otra pregunta que se suelen hacer las personas es si se debe aplicar por medio de un agente, con un agente o por cuenta propia. Y se puede aplicar de las dos formas perfectamente, de una o de la otra, pero por lo general es mucho más recomendable aplicar con un agente porque ya una persona más experta y especializada puede ayudarle a, no sé, a una mejor, a tomar mejores decisiones sobre la provincia, que esa provincia sea la ideal para para el programa de nominación provincial o el mejor programa que se adapte a lo de la experiencia laboral o a la educación, y también puede brindar más consejos. Entonces eso va a hacer que la persona tenga más conocimiento y un plan preparado ya establecido para emigrar a Canadá.
Yes, exactly. So those are where the things, the most important things to think about when applying for a study permit. We definitely recommend to think about all those things before doing anything. It will help you a lot during your process. So Lau, I think we can answer a few questions if there are any.
Yes, I saw a question on Instagram related with we are talking about. This is made by Neil Kerr, and he's asking 1 year versus 2 year program. What do you recommend?
That is a very good question. A lot of agents straightforward recommend a 2 year program. I would say depends on the profile. And the reason is, for example, a 1 year program is going to allow you to work in Canada after you finish your program for 1 year. A 2 year program is going to give you a work permit after graduation of 3 years. Right. So, for example, there are people that have very good profiles and they have really good scores. So maybe they don't need to all that time. You know, they just need a short program, work 1 year, and they will be able to actually apply, for example, through the federal Canadian Express Entry after they worked just 1 year. Now, if your profile is not as good, sometimes not because you're not you have great studies and all of that, but for example, you are an applicant that is, for example, in their 30s, that age, you know, that lowers a lot the score. So maybe because again, it really depends. That will be better suited for a 2 year program where you can actually study and work after 3 years and you can build up your score. So it really depends on the profile. Somebody, for example, this is very common, so maybe this helps. But somebody that just fresh out of high school and wants to come to Canada, I would definitely recommend a 2 year program because they don't have, for example, back home experience. They will likely have to work a little bit longer to get those points. Again, it really depends. Maybe their English is great or they have, but it really depends on your background. And again, a lot of people, you know, the financial aspect of it is also something to consider. So some people say, well, this is the amount I have. I really can't spend more than that. So again, it's a balance. Balance of your profile, your interests, employment, immigration, all of that. And that the length of the program is also goes into that mix.
Resumiendo y también diciendo la pregunta que nos encontramos en Instagram de Nel Kur en español, él está preguntando si 1 año versus 2 años de programa, ¿cuál de estos es más recomendado? Entonces, bueno, primero que esta es una buena pregunta y que la mayoría de personas suelen recomendar 2 años, pero depende. O sea, cuando uno aplica un programa de 1 año, uno consigue un PGWP, que es un permiso de trabajo después de graduarse, de 1 año. Y si uno aplica un programa de 2 años, puede recibir un permiso de trabajo después de graduarse, un PGWP, de hasta 3 años. La diferencia del de 1 año es que sí es posible aplicar a la residencia y todo, siempre y cuando el perfil sea bueno. Entonces, si hay un perfil, ya sea por la edad o porque, no sé, no hizo algún pregrado o algo por el estilo, es mucho más aconsejable tomar un programa de 2 años para después tener un PGWP de 3 años, porque es como para los perfiles que quieran más seguridad. Igualmente, todo esto depende del perfil y es un balance de educación, también el dinero que tenga para poder pagar lo de los programas y la edad. Entonces, es como todo esto viene en lo del plan de estudios, para tenerlo en cuenta y para poder aplicar de la mejor forma.
Yes, that's correct. Do we have anyone else? Any other questions? We have a question here on YouTube. It says, if I'm interested about your services, how can I contact you? So basically, hi, Santiago. Thank you for asking this question. You can see here our website, our email address. We are also, you can send us a message through our social media. We're very there, so you can always just message us and let us know how we can help, what kind of help you're looking for. Today we're talking about education, but immigration, but INGWI, our agency is an immigration firm. So we have several specialists and immigration consultants that can help you with other situations. Just feel free. We will be happy. Just send us a message. We will let you know if we can help and how we can help.
Hay una pregunta en nuestro canal de YouTube de Santiago Zamudio y él nos está preguntando que cómo pueden contactar nuestros servicios en caso de que estén interesados en inmigrar a Canadá. Entonces, como pueden darse cuenta, ahí está el correo info@ingwe.ca. Entonces, nos pueden enviar ahí un email a nosotros y nosotros estaremos dispuestos a asesorar el caso.
Así es. We have time for one more question. I see here it says, hello, I applied for a study permit in October 22nd, and 2 days ago, the review of eligibility started. Do you know how much time they need to finish this review? And my face is because, unfortunately, we do not know these days what's happening. And what do I mean by this? Is basically immigration, it's taking a long time for everything, for all sorts of applications. They normally have a web page with the processing times and they update them. But normally in the past, before COVID and all of this, that website was very accurate to tell you, for example, a study permit application would take 8 weeks on average, right? These days, it's definitely more. They are taking longer than that in general. And it's really hard to keep track because things are changing. Sometimes we receive like a wave of study permit all of a sudden, and then it stops. Even for the student direct stream, that is usually pretty quick. We still have cases pending there, at least for a couple months. So unfortunately, I cannot give you a straightforward answer. I don't think anybody can in terms of processing time. So try to be patient. And remember, I always say this, if you apply for your study permit and you see that your starting date is coming, always contact the school. Let them know that you would like a deferral. Most of school, I don't know any school in Canada that do not allow at least one deferral, okay? So that means that they will push you to the next intake or to the next available intake. Sometimes it can be a year, but sometimes you have programs that are every term. So you have starting dates in the fall, in the winter, and in the spring. That's another recommendation. Because of this, because of the delays in the processing times and all of that, I would definitely suggest to, when you apply for a program, try to apply for a program that at least has two intakes a year. So if something like this happens, then you're able to move on to the next intake without waiting for so long.
I saw a question on Instagram. I think that it's related with the study, so you can answer it. It's made by Tati Jurado. The mm-hmm. question is in Spanish, so I don't know if you prefer the question in Spanish or in English.
Let's do it in Spanish, yeah.
Okay. Sure. Tati Jurado está preguntando, con 2 años de PGWP, ¿puedo tener la residencia en Montreal? Voy a estudiar 1.6 años en un college y me dan el PGWP por 2 años. ¿Con este tiempo es suficiente para la residencia?
Tati, hola, es un poquito difícil, no solo depende del tiempo que estudias, depende de muchos otros factores. Depende de tu edad, de tus estudios, de tu experiencia. Depende del programa a través del que logres aplicar. Por ejemplo, un aspecto súper importante en Quebec es el francés. Para emigrar, tu nivel de francés debe ser bueno. Y aparte de eso, ver, digamos, los otros aspectos, ¿no? En general, mientras más trabajes, más tiempo trabajes, juntas, digamos, más puntos en el programa, por ejemplo, federal, los programas de inmigración de Quebec en sí son un poco particulares, un poco distintos a, digamos, al resto de Canadá. Pero en general, como concepto general, no solo depende del largo, ¿no? Del largo de tu programa. Van a tener que ver aspectos en donde, por ejemplo, el idioma es sumamente relevante.
Okay.
So maybe just one more question. Do we have anybody else there? Reza is helping us here. He's one of our main immigration consultant. He's with you every week, and he's actually replying. It depends on the country where they are applying. Can be from 8 weeks to 4 months, even in some cases. Yeah. So basically, it's what I was saying in terms of it's really hard to give you a specific amount of time. 8 weeks to 4 months. It's a big gap there. So just be patient. The only thing I'm recommending, always please be in touch with your school. The reason I'm saying this is that if your date passes, some schools are going to give you some hard time with a refund of your money. Okay, so always, if you see that you're not going to be able to start your school, always, you know, for example, January 10th is my start date. Immediately talk to the school. For how long can I wait? When can I defer until? All of these questions, be in touch or ask your agent to be on top of it. Okay, so you don't have any issues with refunds or with deferrals, all of that.
We have a question for Renee Nunez on your YouTube channel. He's asking, hello there, once I obtain the study permit, what do I need to get the visa?
Once I obtain the study permit, how long after do I have to obtain the visa?
That's no,
the
question. What do I need to get the visa?
Oh, okay, got it. So basically, the moment you apply for your study permit, you get, if you're approved, you're going to get a passport request letter. That means that basically you are approved and they are requesting that passport so they can issue your visa. So the short answer to that is when you apply for a study permit, they will issue a visa as well. So you don't have to apply for a visa on a separate occasion. Countries, for example, with ETAs, they will issue also an ETA. And usually it's in like the approval letter, you will have the ETA number. So it's not necessary to do it twice. Now, one thing to keep in mind, for example, you come to Canada, you study 1 year, and your study permit expires and you want to extend. Probably your visa is going to expire on the same day of your study permit. So then, once you are here in Canada, you can extend your study permit, and then in that case, you do have to extend your visa on a separate application. But that's after, the first time they issued it for you.
Okay, and I have another comment from Luis Alfredo Gómez Ayala. He said, buenos días, señoritas. Les envío un saludo desde Toronto, Canadá. Muchas gracias por ayudarme en mi proceso.
Hola, Luis. Saludos. So I think we're ready to wrap up, Laura. I think we're good with the questions.
Yes.
Thank you so much for helping me today. I hope this was an informative session for you guys. And always, as usual, we will be live again on Tuesday next week. Reza probably will be joining you guys again. And any questions, anything that you would like to know, feel free to email us or contact us through our social media.
Entonces, chicos, ya estamos llegando al final del directo. Muchas gracias a todas las personas de habla hispana que estuvieron acá haciendo preguntas. Ya saben, si tienen o si están interesados en adquirir nuestros servicios, pueden comunicarse a info@ingwe.ca y ahí podemos asesorarlos a todos ustedes. Y ya nos veríamos el otro martes en otro directo que nosotros hacemos. Ya en ese caso, yo creo que ya estaría Reza.
Perfecto. Bye bye, everyone. Thank you so much.
Bye, everyone.